Good morning. Hope all is well with you today. Welcome to the gray spot. We are back. And it's selfie week. And so it has already been a very incredible week. I am amazed at what God is doing in my life. I'm amazed at what he's doing in your life. Some of the things that you all are sharing with me in text, in my inbox. I feel your prayers. I feel that we are growing together. And I chose selfie week because I felt that people get carried away with the word selfie. They think it's an ideal, ideological, basically, a way to idolize yourself or others. And I think God is doing something more in that moment. I think it's up to us as believers to be looking beyond what society and culture is saying, take it into consideration, but we should always have an understanding and awareness of what's going on beyond the obvious. And there are some things happening in the spirit that we're not always aware of. And so today, I really want to get into the crevices of self-monitoring, or you may want to call it self-control. And I realize those are two different things. When you self-monitor, you are looking at yourself almost from the outside in, where you're surveillancing exactly how you feel about things, and you're surveillancing how you interpret things. It's very important to differentiate between monitoring and controlling. However, they are closely related in that if you monitor, you can have more control in the things that you do. Now, there are layers to this, and there are some controls that should be relinquished to the Creator, because in and of ourselves, we don't always know what the good and perfect will is of God. That is very tricky, and we're going to get into that today. But let me just give you this disclaimer. This is going to be a bit of a hot and heavy day. If you're driving and listening to me, you may want to go back later and listen and take notes. If you're sitting at a desk or in your bed, go ahead and grab your journal. I want to give you time to do that, because I spent a lot of time thinking, praying, meditating on this particular subject, on this particular devotion, because I think self-monitoring and self-control is a part of our life that we all struggle with. There's no human being on earth that from birth is not trying to maintain some type of control and thereby monitoring what they're doing to keep things under control. A case in point is a bowel movement. A bowel movement is one of the first things that a baby can control. A baby can control a bowel movement immediately when they understand, okay, there's something in me that needs to come out. Initially, it just comes out. Their body ejects it, because the way their body is set up as infants, it is automatically willed to get that stuff out of them. But the more their body grows and they get into becoming a toddler and they realize that peeing in this diaper and pooping in this diaper is not comfortable, I need to be able to release myself in a better way, their minds are already churning on how to control those bowels and how to wait until they get behind the couch or they get by themselves. And then eventually they start taking their diaper off, because not only have they began to control when they go, they want to control how it feels when they go and what's left over when they go. And so I use that, not to gross you out this morning, but I use that as an example, because self-control and self-monitoring starts very early in the life of a man and a woman, a boy and a girl. A baby is fashioned with this stuff. And I always say that everything we need, we came with, just like an apple seed. In an apple seed is a tree. One seed, the whole tree. So when you think about self-control and self-monitoring, don't think about it as to a trait that you need to acquire or something that you need to learn how to do or be better at. That is self-depriving of the innate abilities that God has put in you. Now, when God puts his super on our natural, that's when self-monitoring and self-control becomes something different, because we realize that in order to have control, we have to resign certain parts of our control to maintain and to grow. And I think that that is the case with the tree. Just like I gave the example of the apple seed. Once you plant that seed, you water it, you fertilize it, and it begins to take root. Now there's something else happening. Now there are roots going into the ground, and as the roots go to the ground, this is happening, right? The further the roots go, the bigger the tree can get. So now the seed is dependent on other things, right? It's dependent on weather, right? Rain. Can't starve out a tree or else it won't live. It's dependent on sun. Has to have sun. It could be depending on where the tree is planted. It could be dependent upon the birds in the air, how it survives, or the squirrels that nestle in that tree. If it's in a place where those types of animals are plentiful, or if they are short, all of those things make a difference. Even mankind and what they do with the tree. And how often they pluck the tree and pull the fruit off. So at some point, the monitoring and the control that the tree has begins to shift, right? Because it realizes that to sustain, I need some external, I need something beyond myself, a higher source to continue to nourish me so that I can flourish. And so today is heavy. And when I started thinking about monitoring and self-control, my own life and those who are in my 6 degrees of separation, my family, my friends, my coworkers, my community, people that, you know, I may not talk to but once a year, but they're still, you know, terribly connected to me. I thought about rolling in the deep. I thought about the fiery indignation in Adele's voice when she sings Rolling in the Deep. And when you listen to Rolling in the Deep, you get a lot of information and you want to ask the question, how safe is this song? Is she self-monitoring? Is she controlled? Because there's this fire that she's discussing throughout the song. It's an analogy for the emotion and the feeling that's in her body, almost to the point of the body heating up. And she calls it a fever pitch. A fever pitch is denoting all the emotions and being laid bare. So when you are at a fever pitch, it means that you have physically heated up, you're emotionally hot, and it's hitting a vibration or a reverberation. And so when things vibrate through your body, and then when things linger and reverberate through your body, it's an indication to your self-monitoring system that there's something happening and I need to take note. I need to take heed. I might need to warn somebody else because I'm at the place of anger. And that's why a lot of crimes of passion happen. That's why a lot of people do egregious things like hurt other people, kill other people, steal things, because fever pitch is not like a thermostat. It's not like a thermostat. It's something that is intricately woven into the individual. And so I thought about who could I use as an example that has a fever pitch. And I thought about Black Lives Matter. You have to have a certain fiery passion and indignation to take to the streets and determine that inequality anywhere is inequality everywhere. And I will put myself in harm's way, and I will put myself out where people think I shouldn't be in order to get my point across, in order to say what I believe and what I don't believe. And it's quite interesting how when we listen to songs like this, we think, man, Adele's in a bad place. You know, she wrote this song, or she was given the song, or however she acquired it. She's singing it with conviction, so she means it. What the person that is receiving is getting is taking on all of her emotions. And is that healthy? Is that wise? Well, I like to suggest today that it is. When you think about Black Lives Matter, you think about the Holocaust and the fiery indignation as Jews that they had to have to change their life, to transform their people. You think about slaves, black slaves, and how you have to really get down to the nitty-gritty of what is causing a movement to occur in a people where they say, I've taken all, they have a Popeye moment. I've took all I can stand and I can't stand no more. So how does that resonate in your personal life? How does the fever pitch resonate in your personal life? And not just the anger, but the frustration, the fear, the worry. Those are all emotions. And as I always tell you, emotions are indicators. They don't tell us what we should do. They just give us information to help us make an informed decision. So I told you it was going to be deep today, but I wanted to stick to your bones. So let's get started. We're going to roll in the deep, and then I'm going to read some scripture. We're going to pray, and we're going to get with it today because I've got a long day today. And I know you do too. So let's see if we can make it happen. Y'all bear with me now. I'm doing the most today. There's a fire starting in my heart, reaching the fever pitch, and it's bringing me out the dark. Finally, I can see you crystal clear. Go ahead and sell me out and I'll lay your ship bare. See how I leave with every piece of you. Don't underestimate the things that I will do. There's a fire starting in my heart, reaching a fever pitch, and it's bringing me out the dark. The scars of your love remind me of us. They keep me thinking that we almost had it all. The scars of your love, they leave me breathless. I can't help feeling we could have had it all. Rolling in the deep, you had my heart inside your hand, and you played it to the beat. Baby, I have no story to be told, but I have one on you, and I'm gonna make your head burn. Think of me in the depths of your despair, making a home down there, I'm sure you won't be shared. The scars of your love remind me of us. They keep me thinking that we almost had it all. The scars of your love, they leave me breathless. I can't help feeling we could have had it all. Rolling in the deep, you had my heart inside your hand, and you played it to the beat. Could have had it all. Every open door, count your blessings to find out what you're looking for. Turn my sorrow into treasured gold. You pay me back in kind and reaches what you sow.
You're gonna wish you never
had. We could have had it all. We could have had it all. It all. It all, it all, we could have had it all. Rolling in the deep, you had my heart inside your hand, and you played it to the beat. We could have had it all. Rolling. My heart inside give us everything this morning. Woo! Let's pray. Woo, God, that was a lot. And we feel it this morning. But you are gracious. You are faithful. And I just praise you this morning for all of the fire and indignation that you give us when things are not well, when things are going well, but we have this passion burning inside of us, Lord. So as we approach your throne of grace, we approach with humility, with peace, with trembling, God, knowing that when the Holy Spirit is near us, God, anything can be revealed. And so we just ask that you would speak through my vocal cords and think through my mind, none of me and all of you, in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Well, if that didn't get it, I don't know what will. So let's talk about self-monitoring from the perspective as a fruit of the Spirit. So I want to read Galatians 5, and I'm going to start, I believe, at verse 13. In this particular passage, you find Paul talking about self-control, essentially. And of course, he mentions the fruits of the Spirit versus the fruit of the flesh. And it's like I said before with the apple seed, anything that you are sowing in that seed, everything is in that seed. So if you sow prosperity, it's all in that seed. If you sow discord, it's also in that seed. And out of that are going to produce certain fruits. So when we look at Galatians 5, starting at the 13th verse, and we're going to hone in on the fruits of the Spirit, but I want to give this to you for context purposes. So in the 13th verse, starting at the 13th verse, it says, "For you, brethren, have been called to liberty. Only do not use liberty as an opportunity for the flesh, but through love serve one another. For all the law is fulfilled in one word. Even this, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. But if you bite and devour one another, beware, lest you be consumed by one another. I say then, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusts after the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary to one another, so that you do not do the things that you wish. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. Now the works of the flesh are evident, which are adultery, fornication, uncleanliness, lewdness, idolatry, sorcery, hatred, contentions, jealousies, outbursts of wrath, selfish ambitions, dissensions, heresies, envy, murders, drunkenness, revelries, and the like, of which I tell you beforehand, just as I told you in the time past, that those who practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such there is no law. And those who are Christ have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. Let us not become conceited, provoking one another and envying one another." So I want to hone in right at verse 22 and 23. And it says, "But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such there is no law." So what are the fruits of the Spirit exactly? The fruits of the Spirit can be viewed as spiritual disciplines. They each offer a way to an abundant connection to God, self, and others when practiced with fidelity and constraint. I'm going to repeat that. Fruits of the Spirit can be viewed as spiritual disciplines. They each offer a way to an abundant connection to God, self, and others when practiced with fidelity and constraint. So, self-monitoring, self-control. Self-control incites self-monitoring. It is a pattern of living that ensues balance and self-awareness. Some monitor through meditation. Others through self-monitoring as a lifelong journey, meaning it's a part of their daily walk. They always have this sense of consciousness. And many individuals self-monitor as a personal trait, meaning it's almost a part of their personality to be really wise and prudent in their ebb and flow. Others as a means to a particular end. They self-monitor as a means to a particular end to gain more awareness of the shifts in social interactions, personal responses, and spiritual testing. Now, these are the three areas that I'm going to tease out today, because whether you do this intentionally, on accident, if you do it in your quiet time or when you're amongst people, these are the three areas that really help us to understand what God is saying through self-monitoring. And that is through our social interactions, our personal responses, and our spiritual testing. So with social interactions, I want us to think about Colossians, the 4th chapter, and verses 5 through 6. That says, walk in wisdom toward outsiders, making the best use of the time. Let your speech always be gracious, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how you ought to answer each person. So what is this scripture really saying? You know, walk wise when you're with outsiders and make the best use of your time and make sure your speech is gracious and that it's seasoned well, like, you know, a good piece of meat or a vegetable. You know, make sure that when people taste it, it saturates them. They begin to salivate for more of you because your tongue has caused them to salivate with this seasoning that you offer their life, so that you may know how you ought to answer each person. So this is a wisdom in order that you might know how to go about your day. Okay. So there is a great danger of not being wise when people who are not of the household of faith come into your space, seeping into your existence. Now, again, we're talking about social interactions and self-monitoring. So you have to be aware of this danger when people who are not people of faith come into your space or seep into your existence, or maybe they have a form of faith, a form of godliness, but it does not produce the kind of fruit that you need in your life. This is especially true when it comes to division of your time. Your time is precious. It's a high commodity. We all get the same 24 hours in a day, but it's all about what we do with it. This is a space where believers in Christ can be overtaken by a spirit that is contrary to the movement of the Creator in their lives. So you want to be very careful. And as a result of not being mindful of who we yoke up with, in regards to others, things begin to slip into being less monitored living, right? Because when people live loose, they don't monitor as much. And such as lack of great graciousness. So the